the summer of 1986, two things happened that changed pop culture forever. One, Top Gun premiered. And two, aviator sunglasses became a thing. Top Gun was such a cultural phenomenon that it inspired several movies and TV shows to borrow its style, like when a certain animated TV show premiered later that year and basically ripped off the baseline from Fly Into the Danger Zone. This is everything you didn't know about the adventures of the Galaxy Rangers. When I first heard that there was a cartoon from the 80s that was a Western in space on speed, I had to check it out. What does that even look like? It looks like a show with old school Wild West shootouts, thrilling space chases, and bonkers off the wall stuff like a giant bear the size of Godzilla. But that's not all, there's more. There's space cowboys, robot horses, lots of musical numbers, and even an alien chicken that dresses like Ebenezer Scrooge.
What's the meaning of this?
The Adventures of the Galaxy Rangers blends so many genres together that it makes truly no sense on paper, but somehow it totally works. It's part anime, part spaghetti western, part Star Trek, with a little bit of Thundercats and a whole lot of Top Gun. It's almost a shot-for-shot remake of the fighter pilot flick, except with more crotch shots. I mean, they even ripped off a main character's name. That's right, one of the Galaxy Rangers is also named Goose.
Warp coordinates loaded, Ranger One.
Roger, Goose will meet you on the other side.
Except this Goose doesn't die tragically in Tom Cruise's arms. There's just so much random stuff smushed together. It's kind of like PB&J with every type of jelly, or like when you go to IHOP and you use every syrup, which sounds gross, but it's very delicious, trust me. Guys, there are classic Old West ghost towns.
This is the place, town of Sarien.
It's quiet, too quiet.
Robot casinos, alien raves, whatever this is. Oh my God, was that Alf? That was very much Alf, right? Which also premiered the same year. Guys, I think they stole Alf from Galaxy Rangers.
How do you suppose that happened?
But it doesn't matter, because Galaxy Rangers stole, or borrowed, from so many other sci-fi properties. I mean, this is C-3PO with lipstick, right?
Shall we look further?
I don't think I can make it.
Even their main antagonist, the Queen of the Crown, is basically Maleficent.
Welcome, Galaxy Rangers, to my psycho crypt.
Well, well.
Which reminds me of another 80s sci-fi trope the show totally relied on. Lots of technobabble that nobody understands. Good luck with that psycho crypt or whatever lady, I don't know. But they didn't borrow everything. Galaxy Rangers was brimming with original ideas, like the Godzilla bear that I mentioned earlier. Okay, so how do all of these zany, seemingly unrelated elements come together to make such an awesome show? Well, the premise is this. It's the year, you know what? That's a lot of exposition. Just let the intro explain it.
In 2086, two peaceful aliens journeyed to Earth, seeking our help. In return, they gave us the plans for our first hyperdrive, allowing mankind to open the doors to the stars.
So it's 2086, and a purple bunny named Zozo and his super hairy, yet bald friend Waldo travel to Earth and give humans light speed travel, allowing them to explore the cosmos. In exchange, humanity must help the peaceful aliens fend off an evil race called the Crown Empire, also just called the Crown. Boy, someone really hates the monarchy. Was this show written by Ben Franklin?
You took the words right out of my mouth!
You got that right, you man, cat, birthday clown. Honestly, you look like the scariest guy at Chuck E. Cheese cosplaying as Jim in the Holograms. I don't know what's going on. Who is this guy, and why is he wearing a red bow tie under his spacesuit? I have so many questions, and also problems.
I'm just a boy in a rock and roll band.
Now, the main heroes of the show are quintessential 80s alpha males, even though they work for a task force called Beta. That's irony, folks. Beta stands for Bureau for Extraterrestrial Affairs, which is run by Earth's military. Within Beta, there's the Ranger Division, where our heroes serve. And by serve, I mean beat up a bunch of alien weirdos. The Rangers are led by Zachary Fox, spelled with two X's, which is where Jamie Foxx got it from.
Word up.
Zachary is calm under fire and has a plan for any situation. And if that doesn't work, he just shoots stuff with his laser arm. Despite his stoic demeanor, Foxx has some serious inner demons. For one, he has to save his wife from the queen, who's kidnapped her mind and put it in psycho crystals.
Behold!
The most confrontational member of the Rangers is a blonde-haired gunslinger with a cute little neckerchief named Shane Gooseman. He's got the quickest draw in space and the fakest last name on TV ever. Everyone just calls him Goose. He looks and sounds vaguely like Clint Eastwood, and he's just as incoherent.
I had to go down and say hello to the man in the moon. Get us out of here. This moon is history.
Then there's Walter Doc Hartford, the Brainiac. He's handy with tech and carries a small portable computer named Q-Ball that helps him and the Rangers get out of jams. Doc's a computer whiz and a dancing machine.
Not bad, babe. For a hummer.
Did that robot call him babe? Are they allowed to do that? And did Doc pronounce human? Hummin?
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 This is one nutty show.
By the way, that slick cyborg with the sweet shades is his sassy sidekick, Buzzwang. With a name like that, I do hope he was homeschooled.
This is embarrassing.
When he wasn't fighting crime, he was breakdancing, which is the most 80s hobby ever.
Everybody's rocking. Everybody's rocking.
Rounding out the team of heroes is Nico, who had vague psychic powers, evidenced by her frequent use of the hand-to-the-head thinking face, a la Jean Grey. It's like this. Tangent, have you ever noticed how many women in the 80s were vaguely psychic? You have Deanna Troi, who was an empath. You got Cyndi Lauper in Vibes, very underrated movie, by the way. Raven on Teen Titans, Psylocke when she was British the first time, Tangina from Poltergeist, Chitara had that sixth sense thing, Shira could communicate with animals, Nancy Reagan even used to get psychic advice, which maybe somehow explains this photo.
I pity the fool!
Nico, however, mostly defied this stereotype, which was novel for an animated heroine at the time. She wasn't just a token presence or a romantic interest, but an active member of the team who took action in her own hands.
We must help you return to your home!
Shocking atomic beings who understand me!
In a medium that was specifically created to sell toys to little boys, Nico was the ultimate exception. She kicked butt, made her own decisions, and often took center stage, literally.
No,
there's so much singing and dancing. Is this a variety show? When do the solid gold dancers appear?
Another good band, Larry.
Perhaps Nico's greatest strength, even beyond her fierce independent streak, were her bangs. Seriously, there are some very important bang work going on here.
Thanks for everything!
No, thank you, Nico. Your bangs will live on in our hearts forever. And if that hasn't convinced you that Nico's the best, then check out this beautiful fan tribute. Now, what made the Galaxy Rangers special, aside from Nico's bangs, were the bionic implants that gave them enhanced abilities. To activate these powers, they just had to tap their sheriff's badges, and presto, they became superheroes. And they all had different special abilities. Their powers would manifest in a variety of fun, fantastical ways, like turning into metal in the case of Goose. Or conjuring a very silly computer program.
Recircuit the self-destruct mechanism in the reactor, and get back here on the double.
Sorry, Doc. Goose's power is way cooler. Together, the Rangers fought numerous villains. Chief among them was the ruler of the crown, the Queen, aka Maleficent.
I am in control of the situation now.
She was the show's ultimate big bad, hell-bent on destroying the Galaxy Rangers and the League of Planets. She reappeared often, usually in pursuit of psycho crystals, which allow her to control the minds of anyone she wants.
I will send you to Earth as my most powerful slaver lord in charge of a battle fleet.
She was also a sorceress who used her powers to torture her enemies like Zachary Foxx, who she pushed to the brink of a mental breakdown. She was an imposing boss lady, which was unique for arch villains at the time, who were typically dudes. She was the no-nonsense boss who oversaw an army of silly male underlings.
There are things that you wish to tell me?
The drain pipe's connected to the S-pipe. The S-pipe's connected to the waste pipe.
You could say she was a trailblazer who paved the way for other villainesses like Rita Repulsa and Angela Pickles.
Not that information!
The queen was always stern and singularly focused while her flunkies evolved into campy caricatures. Just take, like, Captain Kidd. You know, that alien chicken I mentioned earlier? Here he is at his most nefarious.
Bird! Kid!
Martha, my petunia, love of my life.
And don't forget his pet monkey, Squeegee.
No chance for you, no chance for you.
Then there's the Queen's scientist, Lazarus Slade, which is the coolest Bond villain name. Also just coolest name, Lazarus Slade. Oh my God, what are you, like a cool lawyer?
I'm your key to final victory.
And what is that accent, Matthew McConaughey? Does Lazarus Slade also do Lincoln car commercials that make no sense?
It's not about hugging trees. It's not about being wasteful either.
Then there was the Scarecrow, who was super creepy and apparently never realized he looked exactly like a scarecrow.
Scarecrow! Aha! I like that!
Last but not least was my personal favorite, the bow-tie-wearing, rainbow-wigged Catman, Nimrod. What was going on with him? He had fur, but also flesh. Where did he come from? What was his genetic makeup? So many questions that may never be answered. And his name had to be Nimrod. It's so good. But looking insane wasn't all Nimrod had going for him. He was so devoted to his queen, he even sang about her.
Nimrod and the Slaver Lord!
Nimrod and the Slaver Lords is such a great name, as are many of the other villain names, like Darkstar, Jackhammer, and Riker Kilbane, who you know by his name alone was going to appear shirtless at some point. The colorful characters gave the show a whimsical personality, but the storytelling was serious and nuanced, often satirizing classic TV and literary tropes, like the mysterious stranger figure from Westerns who rides into town in Galaxy Stranger.
That's quite a dragonfly you got there.
And that's some horse. It nearly blinded me. I didn't know what was coming.
Bet you'd love to take a ride on this!
Or when they find themselves in a whodunit in Murder on the Andorian Express.
Oh no! Kilby!
They even encounter their own Alice in Wonderland in the episode Ariel. There were 65 episodes in all, but without one consistent arc, so writers had the latitude to experiment with high-concept stories without worrying about continuity. But they also grounded the characters in strong relationships, as evidenced in the second episode, New Frontier, where we get to see the team in action for the first time. Though they succeed in their mission, they suffer a great loss.
Until her psycho crystal is found, Eliza Fox still is linked to the Queen and must be put in stasis.
Galaxy Rangers took a lot of chances on screen as well as behind the scenes. For one, the animation was done in Japan by the historic TMS Animation Studio, which was responsible for many famous anime properties like Detective Conan, Sonic X, and Little Nemo, as well as American classics like Batman the Animated Series and DuckTales. With anime flourishes and a bright color palette, TMS gave Galaxy Rangers a distinctive look. A look that would be replicated a year later for Bionic 6, another sci-fi animated show about soldiers with superpower implants.
A family brought together by fate and given superpowers through the miracle of modern science.
If you want to know more about those guys, check out our Bionic 6 episode. Unfortunately, they didn't have a chain-smoking Ferengi-looking dude. Too bad. Just like the animation, the theme song also kicked major ass. A true 80s power ballad in every way called No Guts, No Glory. No guts, no glory. So 80s, with even a very 80s catchphrase. No game, no game. No pain, no gain. Just like Jane Fonda always said. Even Clark Kent knows that.
Clark Kent goes the other one!
No pain, no gain.
For the second half of the series, they had a new theme song for the end credits called Rangers Ride Forever, which was performed by acclaimed UK rock band FM, who hold the record for most slow-motion pan shots in a music video. Fact? No way of knowing.
I'd like a second opinion.
Now, they weren't the only famous voices involved with Galaxy Rangers. Oh no. Not when Mr. Law and Order himself is doing one of the voices. That's right, the great Jerry Orbach voiced Zachary Fox, and he took the part fresh off his role playing the coach in Brewster's Millions.
Come on, Monty, keep it in there, keep it in there!
But it was his role as Zach that helped prepare him for his star turn in Law and Order, with intense line deliveries that required the utmost gravitas.
I remember Doc Holliday, an old 19th century myth. Wasn't there a mid-20th century movie about him? With, who was it? Kurt Lancaster? Nah.
But he wasn't the only noteworthy actor on the show. Laura Dean, the voice of Nico, went on to play Sophie from Friends, which you would only know if you were obsessed with Friends, which I'm not. Sorry. Then there's the queen herself, Corinne Orr, whose career stretches all the way back to her days as Trixie on Speed Racer.
Who'd expect to find a field of flowers in a place like this? It's mighty peculiar.
They're certainly beautiful.
And don't forget the storied voice actor Earl Hammond, the voice of that silly alien chicken Captain Kidd, who you might not recognize as Mumra in Thundercats,
Mumra!
Or Monstar in Silverhawks.
Monstar!
Though, I still think this is his best line reading.
I want my bird back!
The actors weren't the only talent to continue working in animation. Many of the writers would go on to write for Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders, or Starla and the Jewel Riders for viewers outside the US, which was also created by the creator of Galaxy Rangers, Robert Mandell. And one of those writers is still writing in animation today, Cyrus Forrest, who wrote the story for the first Kung Fu Panda. His first TV writing credit was on Galaxy Rangers for the episode Renegade Rangers, which is when Goose basically turns into a blonde Logan.
I want to see the monster!
No, Tommy! You can't go up there!
No, Tommy deserves it. He ran straight into that sinkhole. Look where you're going, Tommy. There could be sinkholes anywhere. Now, like all good 80s cartoons, of course, there were toys, but not many. In fact, Galaxy Rangers wasn't even made to sell toys, which was almost completely unheard of. Almost every other animated TV show had toys lining the shelves at the time. You had Thundercats, He-Man, G.I. Joe, the real Ghostbusters, and on and on. But for some reason, they never made a ton of Galaxy Rangers toys. Galoob made a small line of toys featuring 6 characters, 3 cyber steeds, and 2 toy guns. But they're pretty rare. Just like the idea that an 80s cartoon that wasn't made to sell toys could exist. That's because The Adventures of Galaxy Rangers was more focused on developing characters, exploring adult themes, and crafting good stories. Which is why fans love this show through and through, even though there was never a proper series finale. The last episode was a standalone adventure called Heartbeat that saw the Rangers tangle with the Scarecrow as Doc convinces a primitive race to shed their fear of technology. Though one of the final lines of the series provides a good snapshot for the show's place in animated history.
For eons, we Tarkonians have shunned high technology. But times change, and we must change with them.
We will blend the old ways with the new.
Which is exactly what The Adventures of the Galaxy Rangers did, blending the old ways of animation with the new. Thanks to their innovative animation style, high concept stories, and subversion of gender stereotypes, Galaxy Rangers will always be remembered as being ahead of its time for stuff like this. A giant prairie dog? Look at those chompers, they're almost as big as Iceman's. Ugh, why? Anyway, I'm telling you, go watch Top Gun again, and we dare you to say there's no influence here. Why don't you Tom Cruise, thank you, into the comments and let us know.
I never liked long goodbyes.